and the fifth trumpet. And we're telling you this because just as we are seeing so many things in the scripture coming to pass in these days, as we watch the deterioration of the financial markets and the crumbling of the things of man and the move toward one world government, a new world order, as it takes place before our very eyes, we should know. Instruct them in the Word of God and out of the Scriptures when they do arrive. And people are being edified. Many of you knew many of the guests that were here Sunday who are coming from neighboring churches as God draws them with the love of God. Can the church say amen? In Revelation, I think we want to pick up where we left off before. And if I remember correctly, we were around the ninth chapter of the book of Revelation. And the purpose of us reading the book of Revelation on tonight, I would say again to you, this is what we refer to as the apocalypse. Someone say apocalypse. Someone say eschatology. Eschatology is expelled by theologians as E-S-C-H-T-O-L-O-G-Y, eschatology. And this has to do with that which pertains to dispensational truth with regard to prophecy and that which is relevant to a prophetic future dispensation. This is eschatology, Brother Ian, and this is what we're dealing with, that which is going to come to pass. Can we say amen? Of course, in my office, there is a book on my board table. It is a Bible dictionary. It's a maroon Bible dictionary. If you would bring that to me, I want to give you something out of that tonight to help you with the book of Revelation. Can we say amen? And so this is what we are dealing with now. We're in the ninth chapter of the book of Revelation, and we are going to begin with verse number 1 and deal with the final three woes. Someone say woe, woe, woe. Let's read 8 and 13 out loud together. Let's read. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, everyone, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound. And this is to say, as we've indicated in our previous Bible classes, that these three woes will be far worse than any of the preceding four that have already taken place. There have been four trumpets blown, or there have been four woes that have taken place at this point in the tribulation period. Can the church say amen? We are now in the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period that began at the beginning of the 8th chapter of the book of Revelation. The first 3.5 years of the 7-year tribulation period, as you know, the tribulation period will be 7 years. The first 3.5 years of the 7-year tribulation period have expired through the preceding chapters, particularly through chapter 7 and verse 17. In chapter 8, when the seventh seal was broken by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as he sat on the throne, and as the Son, he took the book and broke the seals to execute the judgment of God upon the inhabitants of the earth. This is the seventh seal, and of course, in the 8th chapter, in verse number 1, this began the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period. And there are four trumpets that have been blown up to verse number 12. Each angel that has blown, that's the wrong book, it's a smaller one. Each angel that has blown and sounded, should I say, each trumpet has released in the sounding of each trumpet the judgment that God has determined to be executed upon the inhabitants of the earth that are left here, because everyone that will be saved at this point in the 8th chapter of the book of Revelation will have been saved. And there is no one that will be saved in the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period. Therefore, this is simply one level of judgment after another coming upon the inhabitants of the earth because they have refused to believe God. They have rejected the gospel. They have rejected the message of God. They have rejected the word of God. They have rejected the truth. They have put their confidence in their own flesh, in their own conceits and their own deceits, and they have completely been turned over now to reprobates, if you would call them that. Thank you. I think that may be it. And so we are picking up in verse 13, the last three woes. Someone say, woe, woe, woe. And the reason why that is spoken of in that sense is because these last three woes will be so much worse than the first three that there will be absolutely, someone say, no comparison. Now then, in the 9th chapter, let's pick up the first of the last three woes, and the 5th trumpet. And we're telling you this because just as we are seeing so many things in the scripture coming to pass in these days, as we watch the deterioration of the financial markets and the crumbling of the things of man and the move toward one world government, a new world order, as it takes place before our very eyes, we should know the stage is being set for these events to take place. All right, chapter 9, verse number 1, let's read. And the 5th angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Now, again, I told you last week, the bottomless pit is the lake that burneth with fire and brimstone. This is what he has the key to. This angel, sounds the trumpet, a star falls from heaven, and to him, that is to this angel, was given the key to the bottomless pit, the lake of fire. And you are well aware that the lake of fire will open its mouth in what's referred to in another place in the scripture as the land of Shinar. I'm not going through all those scriptures tonight. We have taught this subject. Bishop Paddock has taught this subject. It is on tape for your review. You can purchase the tapes to get even more specific details than what I am teaching tonight. So all of the gaps have been filled. And if whatever you don't get tonight, you certainly have in the library of this church the availability of that measure of truth and that revelation to fill the gaps and answer the questions from a scriptural basis. I simply will say at this point, at the bottomless pit, the lake of fire will open its mouth in the land of Shinar, which is also known as the land of Babylon, which today is known as the land of Iraq. Right there where we have been fighting the war on terror for the past several years, since President Bush did say that the attack by Al-Qaeda at 9/11, 2001, in New York on the World Trade Centers, the towers there, as well as in the field in Pennsylvania and the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. Since this was declared as an act of war and aggression against the United States of America, we have been at war in Iraq. And this is because the scriptures have called for these events to take place. Many people don't accept that. They don't believe that because they don't know and don't believe in Bible prophecy. So they have no reason, they have no, no clear understanding as to why we are in Iraq. We're in Iraq because the Bible said we would be in Iraq. We are in Iraq because as far as the Bible is concerned, the Jerusalem, is the navel of the earth. And this was taught many years ago, and I guess maybe I'm making a mistake calling his name, and this Elder Mitchell was sitting in a Bible class in Kalamazoo. And he went to the library and studied and came back and called himself correcting Bishop Paddock and said, no, Norway is the center of the earth. And we get our time zones from Norway. So Bishop Paddock had to correct him, let him know that that may be from the perspective of secular education. But when we're dealing with theological education, when we're dealing with the scriptures, all of your directions and all of your times in the scripture are measured from Jerusalem, not from Norway. So Jerusalem is the navel of the earth when we deal with scripture. And this is why these events that are taking place in the Middle East are simply for us to pay attention, because it is to let us know what time we are in, or the times that we are in, and tell somebody we're in the last days. And so the lake of fire will open its mouth in the land of Shinar, right there in Iraq. And it will be here that those individuals who have rejected God will be cast into the lake that burneth with fire and brimstone. And that is not what the scripture is dealing with. It's simply making the point that this angel sounded the fifth trumpet to begin the last three woes, and a star fell from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. This angel apparently had the key to open the bottomless pit. And of course, open it, he did. Verse 2, let's read. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. Now, I told you about this last week. I'm just going over this again. It's much like it was if in Mount St. Helens. Now, I wasn't there. I was alive. I remember Mount St. Helens when it erupted in Washington State. And it blew, it blew ash thousands of miles into the heavens, the air. And I saw the special on the Weather Channel where the entire city of Seattle, well, I guess this is where it was, turned pitch dark. You couldn't see anything. The man was filming it, driving a car. He couldn't even see his headlights on in front of him. The dust, the volcanic ash, covered his entire car. It wiped out tens of thousands of acres of trees, killed hundreds and thousands of people, and that ash spewed so far in the heavens, it circled the entire globe that we are living on today. Now, this actually took place. This is no hyperbole. This is no exaggeration. Now, you think about that now, the smoke of this particular bottomless pit, the lake of fire, if you please, it will be as a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of it. Now, you think about this now. If this happened in Washington State, when Mount St. Helens erupted, then people don't think these kind of things can happen. But they have already happened. They have already taken place, and these are historical milestones that are testimonies and witnesses to us that if they have taken place, and the scripture says they shall take place, turn to your neighbor and say, they will take place. And turn to your neighbor and say, and you better not be here. You better be in the rapture where you belong. You better be in heaven where you have been saved to be. You have no business being anywhere but with Jesus Christ. And those in my television audience and my radio audience, I'm talking to you too. You better not be here. You better get your fanny over here and get saved and walk with God so you can make it to heaven. Can the church say amen? Amen. All right, now that I've had my spiel, verse number 3 read, and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. Now this means there were stingers in their tails. These locusts came out of the bottomless pit. Now I don't know what this is. I have to leave this to your imagination. I have no clue what this is, but these are locusts. We know that when locusts come, they generally attack vegetation. They come, they eat up all the vegetation and leave virtually nothing. I have an article in my file in my office where in the southern parts of this country, because of a drought many years ago, the locusts came, attacked the crops, and left virtually nothing. Now, these locusts are not coming to attack the crops. These locusts are coming to attack the men that are left here on earth during the tribulation period. And the description of them is a horrific thing. They have stingers in their tail. Anyone that knows about a scorpion knows it's a small creature. And they have this hook on their tail, and they have a stinger in it. And the poison, when they hit you with that stinger, the poison enters your bloodstream. And it is as though someone has set you on fire from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. You feel like you are completely on fire. Turn to someone and say, you had better not be here. You better be in the rapture where you belong. But for those who will be left here, Brother Ryan, this will be what they are faced with. Verse number 4, and it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men, someone say it again, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. Well, you just read the ones who got the seal of God in their forehead when the 7th chapter of the book of Revelation. That was 144,000 in verses number 1 through 4. And then the number which no man can number, which are referred to as palm bearers. And they were caught up in the first half of the first three and a half years of the tribulation period, because they refused to take the mark of the beast, and therefore they could not buy or sell. So they had to, in fact, give their lives. They were the martyrs of the tribulation period. They turn to someone and say, they are gone. So obviously, then these things that are coming, these locusts, whatever they are, coming out of the bottomless pit, with stingers in their tails, going forth to hurt men, they're not going to hurt those men, because everyone that will be saved at this point of the scripture in the tribulation period will have been saved and will have been caught up to God. Remember now the two witnesses, Elijah and Moses, they were killed, their bodies laid in the streets for 3 days, and they were caught up to God. Remember now this 144,000 were caught up to God and stand before God on the sea of glass. Remember now the number which no man can number was caught up before God and stands on the sea of glass. And all of these are servants of God. We, the church, will be the bride because we were caught up before any of this took place. And they will be the servants. Are you listening to me? All right, verse number 5. And what happened? And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. Now, this will be a period that these locusts will come, and they will torment those who are left here during the tribulation period for 5 months. Now, you think about this. What's going to happen? Read. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. So now then, this would then be, they would strike men during this period of time, the poison will run into their bloodstream, and they then will feel as though their entire body has been set on fire. Now, death sometimes can be merciful. People are suffering so much pain, they just, to put themselves out of suffering and misery, they want to take their life. So as a result of this, many individuals will try to commit suicide. But the scripture says the following. Verse number 6, read. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. That means, as I told you the other night, you can take a gun and shoot your head full of holes, and you just have a big headache. For every bullet you put in your brain, your headache will elevate. You can take the blood, take a razor, slit your wrist, and drain every drop of blood out of your body, and God will not take the spirit of life out of you, because this is why a man dies, because God takes the spirit of life out of him. But during this 5-month period, God will refuse to take the spirit of life out of those who are left here during this period of the tribulation period. That means you can go downtown to Jackson. There was a man that did this several years ago. We talked about him the other night. And you can go to the highest building in downtown Jackson, the Jackson County building. climb up on the top floor, jump out of the window down to onto the pavement beneath, and crush every bone in your body and lay there like a quivering mass of jelly, and you will simply have added to your misery. Now, not you. Turn to someone and say, not me, because I'm not going to be here. If you got good sense, you won't be here. If you have good sense, you'll be in heaven, as Self-Commissioned Bishop Collier preached on Sunday. You will get yourself ready for the rapture and get up out of this place and not be trapped and with the preoccupation of the sin and destruction that is coming upon the inhabitants of this earth. Are you listening to me? All right. Now, what is the description of these things? Read. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle. And on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold, everyone. And their faces were as the faces of men, verse 8. And they had hair as the hair of women. And their teeth were as the teeth of lions, verse 9. And their breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle, verse 10. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men. How long? Now, can you imagine what this looks like? These creatures coming up out of the bottomless pit by the thousands. Can you imagine somebody that coming after you? I mean, think with me now. You open the door and hear these things flying at you. Look at the description. They're shaped like a horse. They have crowns on their head like a king, a face like a man, hair like a woman, and teeth like a lion. Can you imagine something like that coming after you? Turn to someone and say, you better not be here. You had better not be here. You had better be in heaven. I'm about to laugh myself out the pulpit. It's so terrible. You had better be in heaven where you belong. This is going to be a terrible thing. Can we say amen? All right. Now, so then, who is this? Verse 11. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. Whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon. But in the Greek tongue, have his name Apollyon. And what is this? One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. Now, Apollyon means destroyer. This is left to your imagination now, because I don't know what this is. Some have said this is tanks. They say because they compare it to World War II. You remember now. Hitler, this comes on television, the History Channel, almost once a week, where Hitler tried to invade Russia. And when he tried to invade Russia, the worst snowstorm in the history, almost of the world, hit Russia, and his tanks and all of his military equipment got stuck, and the Russians were ready and drove them out of Russia back across the border. But he gave what is referred to as the order to scorch the earth. And he executed, or they executed, what became known as the scorched earth policy. That meant those tanks, as they were retreating, they had flamethrowers built into them, and they shot flames and burned up everything in their path and left absolutely nothing. This became known as the scorched earth policy. Now, I don't know if this is what this is. All I can say is we leave it up to your imagination. But as I've said already, you just better not be here. You and I had better beware. We better be in the rapture. And we have nothing to worry about, because we are, as I will read to you before I close tonight, we are pre-millennials. That means we believe there's going to be a rapture before the millennial. And excuse me, we are pre-tribulationists and pre-millennials. When I say premillennialists, I meant pre-tribulationists. We believe the rapture would take place before the tribulation. Now, the Catholics teach a doctrine that there is no tribulation as such, that it is what the church is going through as we speak. And this is the Catholic teaching on the tribulation period. This is not our teaching. And then there is the post-millennialists who believe, or post-tribulations, excuse me, who believe that the church is going through the tribulation. And then there is a group of them that refer to themselves as the futurists, that believe that the church is going through a portion of the tribulation. But the point in case is, the scripture does not teach that. The scripture is clear that we, the church, will not be in the tribulation period. We will be caught up prior to. The book of Revelation is clear from the fourth chapter of the book of Revelation that we will be called up hither before these things begin. Are you listening to me? And by and large, I'm sure we know this has not come to pass yet on our watch during our time. Are you listening to me? All right, let's read verse number 12. I'm going to take you through the rest of this quickly. One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter.